Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. The afternoon of day two. This lady needs no introduction, really, but I am going to introduce her. It's Alison Moriarty, Fleet Risk Director at Matrix IQ. And we're going to look about agency drivers and complying with the law, but also what else you should be doing. Alison, thank you.
Good afternoon. Really impressed, actually. There's this many people on day two at 2 o'clock with a rail strike, so thank you for making the effort. So I will be touching on agency drivers in respect of it's much more difficult to have control over agency drivers than your own drivers, because obviously you don't necessarily have those checks and balances in place. But more holistically, I'm going to be looking at safe and legal and what the difference is and why we need to think a little bit beyond what just is legal. So as introduced, I'm Alison Moriarty, now work at Matrix IQ, but actually come from an operational background. So I looked after the fleet risk in big operational fleets such as Skanska, Enterprise, Arriva, M Group. So I've worked with a number of fleets in that role. So now, obviously, we're working on with lots of different clients, mainly from the utility, construction, civil engineering sector. One of the things that I also do, just to make me doubly popular with everybody, is that I'm also a magistrate, which is something that I've done for 20 years next year. So it seems maybe a bit of an anomaly for a magistrate to stand up and say it's not all about the law. But it is, but it's about not looking at the law as kind of the final step on making sure you've got a safe fleet and making sure that you actually fulfil all your obligations, and whether they are moral obligations or legal obligations, because as we'll come on to a bit further, sometimes there are bits of legislation that catch you that you might not think necessarily around fleet, but they're part of the wider sort of health and safety legislation. So I think it's definitely about, you know, legal's great, compliance brilliant, but let's put safe at a slightly higher level, and maybe we need to put a bit more thought around how that works with your individual fleets. So these are the kind of questions that I always want people to ask themselves. So the sort of, is compliance not enough? Well, compliant to what? So maybe compliance to certain bits of legislation around transport, but there are lots and lots of different areas of legislation out there. So to say you're compliant, you know, we think about things like all license compliance if you've got an HGV fleet. It's great if you can demonstrate that you are compliant with those things, but is that actually enough? And does that fulfill what you need to fulfill? So do I need to do more? I'd say yes for everybody. So obviously we want everybody to be compliant, but we need to be thinking much further about what we do in the fleet. And kind of the next one, which is a bit controversial, I guess, is whether legislation is based around safety. And I think if we look at some of the things that happened, particularly over lockdown, where certain things were relaxed, and I know that probably some people running large fleets breathed a sigh of relief. I think what we had to ask ourselves there is, did that actually affect safety? Now, looking at the kind of speeding events and all those sort of things, now it's come properly out of the lockdown, actually some of the changes we made and some of the parameters we stretched a little bit around maintenance and MOTs and all that, I don't know that they had anything to do with safety. And I think it was more about finance and helping companies, which is not a bad thing, because without a fleet, most companies can't operate. So I totally understand that. But I don't think there is a set of legislation around all the things that need to be. So for instance, one of the things that I always talk to mixed fleets about, and this is something that when I worked at Skanska, it was a decision we took that wasn't popular initially, was looking at, say, driver's hours rules. So I'm sure those of you who are all involved in fleet in this room, we know that there are EU rules and there are domestic rules, and they're very, very different in terms of the amount of hours you can drive legally, the rest periods, you know, all those sort of things are very, very different. And I think what we've got to ask ourselves around that area is, so I understand, you know, heavy vehicles, if you're involved in something, probably going to do more damage. But actually, as a driver, am I less fatigued because a different piece of legislation covers me? So if I'm driving X amount of hours, does it actually make me less fatigued because I'm driving under domestic rules? So of course it doesn't. You know, fatigue's a really important issue, something that we should look at. And we actually took the decision that we'd put all our drivers, whether they were van drivers or HGV drivers, that we would look at fatigue and driver's hours in the same way right across the fleet. Again, there was nothing legally that meant we had to do that, but we just felt that it was the right thing to do to improve safety. Obviously, we'll all be aware that, I think it was last year now, the BFLC, so everybody had to go and do the training and pass it so they could tow. That was taken away. So now pretty much you've got it on your licence once you've passed your test. Legally, you can put somebody out to tow as long as they're under the weight limit, get them out towing. Legal, absolutely legal. Is that safe? Is it safe to put somebody in a vehicle who might have passed a test a matter of months ago, never done any training at all around towing, never been assessed, and say, right, you're fine to go out on the road now and do that? Absolutely not. And luckily, a lot of the fleets that we deal with and a lot of other fleets out there have taken the wise decision, actually, we're still going to do that training. So there might not be the qualification at the end of it, but actually, in terms of upskilling the drivers, we still need to do that. You know, our responsibility to those drivers and the public and everybody else on the road hasn't been diminished because a little bit of legislation has been removed. So really, really important that we keep these things in mind all the time. So young and inexperienced drivers as well. So one of the things that we find now is quite a lot of apprenticeships within big companies put the young people through the driving test. Great, really, really good thing to do. And then they do that in a car, they pass the test, and then they say, brilliant, Jack, you passed your driving test now, get some more duties, here's the key, that's your van, we're gonna start putting you on the road in that. That driver has never driven a van probably before in their life. It's legal for you to do that. You can just give them the keys and send them off. They've no rear view mirror. It handles differently. Your braking distances are different. So again, you don't legally have to do this, but why would you not do van driver familiarisation with these people? You know, you have to think all the time of not just your own responsibilities to them, and you have a duty of care to make sure they're safe, obviously, but we've all got, anybody who runs a fleet, I've got a duty of care to everybody on the road. So it's really important when somebody goes off in your vehicle, which will probably be liveried. So let's face it, you know, now it's been tried in the court of public opinion, isn't it? YouTube wasn't around when I was younger, and I thank my lucky stars for that, because now something happens, it's up, there's thousands and thousands of hits in an hour, whether it was necessarily your driver's fault or not. If you're the one at the side of the road with a crushed van and a car in front of it, and you're, you know, your company name across it, you're already being tried in people's heads. So the more you can lessen the risk of those incidents happening with your company, the better it is for your reputational risk, as well as for, obviously, for safety. So apart from those three issues, what are some of the other things? And there's absolutely no way that we can cover everything today because, A, I don't know everything, which sometimes comes as a shock to me, but I absolutely find out every day that that's the case. But it's worth thinking about one or two kind of other things in there. So drugs and alcohol testing. Again, do you know, do your company do it? What are your rules around it? Do you do random testing post-incident? Do you do where there's been maybe somebody just caused? So somebody said, John comes in on a Monday morning. I know he goes out Sunday night. He always smells of alcohol. Have you got those sort of things in place? Because again, health and safety legislation means that really you have to be sure that people are fully trained, they're fit to do the job and all those sort of things. There's no specific bit of legislation that says you must DNA test your drivers. But just because it's not legislation doesn't mean that you shouldn't be doing it. Really, really important, absolutely vital for the driver and, again, everybody else on the road. We absolutely need to be doing these things. So well-being, I think, is much more prevalent now. So we talk about mental health a lot, and I think that seems to be the focus, which is really, really important. It's not everything. So while it's really good that we're looking at that now, what else are we looking at? Are we looking to say, well, our drivers, particularly long-distance drivers, are they eating properly? Are they overweight? Could that be causing sleep apnea? So going back to fatigue, you know, are those drivers now actually posing a danger to the other road users because they're having little micro sleeps? And we know that drivers, when questioned in a break survey, one in three drivers said they think they've had a little micro nap at one time or another. I mean, that is, when you think how many people on the road, it's an amazing figure. So again, that's all about health and well-being and what are we doing, how are we encouraging our drivers. I worked with a couple of really big HGV fleets, and they have really nice restrooms for the drivers so that when they're not in the vehicle, they've got vending machines. And what are in those vending machines? I don't think it'll surprise anybody to know that there are a selection of crisps and chocolate. So there's nothing there to say to those drivers, oh, do you know what? We've got fruit here, we've got this, and we've actually got some leaflets if you'd like to do some checks. We put like a wellbeing van to go around. This is years and years ago. And offered drivers, not compulsory, you come in, you can have a blood pressure check, you can have a heart monitor. Just allowed them to go to depot and drivers to go in. So many drivers came back afterwards to thank the company because they'd found things that they had no idea. Really, really high blood pressure. You know, things that were heart attacks waiting to happen. And it allowed them then to make lifestyle changes. So again, you've no legislation to tell you need to do that, but why would you not want a driver to be healthy? You wouldn't put a vehicle on the road that hadn't had service maintenance and an MOT check. You just wouldn't do it. But why do you not MOT your driver? And when you look at this then in that context of agency driver, are you putting all this into place with them? Or are you expecting the agency to do that? Do you think that when you get somebody who is an agency driver who doesn't know your culture, so they don't know, even if you've got the best culture in the world in your organisation, they're not part of that. You know, do they get inducted? Do they understand what your expectations are? Do they know that you care about this stuff and that actually you put things in place for their benefit? But if they're an agency driver, are they really part of that? Do they feel part of the family? Are they, you know, do they feel open to come to you maybe and say, actually, I feel really, really tired today. I don't know if I can drive. I've got a new baby. I've been up all night. What's your policy for that? Do you then ring the agency and say, oh, don't want that driver again, or not paying that driver? I suspect most companies have to do that from a financial standpoint. Without a policy, without something there that people understand, are you driving things underground that maybe your own driver might feel that they can say to you, but would an agency driver feel the same and actually feel that they're confident enough to come and have those discussions with you? Electric vehicles. So you get an agency or your own drivers. I mean, these things are applicable to both. But you get an agency driver in onto your fleet and you say, oh, this part of the fleet now, we've moved to EV. Brilliant, we're all into decarbonising, absolutely fantastic. But this driver has never driven an electric vehicle. Does he know how to drive an electric vehicle? The differences in how it handles. Does he understand how quickly it accelerates? Does he understand how much more aware of everything else around him he is? Because that vehicle's not making a sound when it's setting off, when there's people in the way, where there's pedestrians. There's all these things that hopefully you've something in place for your own drivers, but again, are you making sure that everybody coming into your organisation and in terms of health and safety legislation, if they're driving your vehicle or on behalf of you and being paid for that journey, you have a duty of care and you have responsibility. You can't outsource responsibility. You can outsource things being done for you, but if they're doing a trip for you, and I would say the same for things like your grey fleet drivers who may be driving their own vehicles and claiming expenses, when that's happening, if you're paying for that journey, you absolutely have to know that they've got a valid licence, that they've got valid insurance for business use, that their vehicle's maintained safely. They're doing your journey, you have that responsibility to make sure they're safe. So, monitoring driver behaviour. So, most people now probably have some form of telematics. And I'm guessing that if you do something with the data, fingers crossed, because obviously you're kind of more culpable if you know that something's happening. You know, one of your drivers, and again, an agency driver, you don't know that guy. You know, you build up a rapport with your drivers. You kind of know the good drivers, the drivers you need to keep an eye on, the drivers you might need to do a bit of extra training with. Guy comes in from an agency, you don't know that person. You don't know them at all. So you can't judge them. Are you monitoring them? Do they fall under the same telematics policy? Are you looking at the driver behaviour? And then actually, if using agency drivers is something you do quite a lot as a company, are you feeding back to the agency and saying, these guys are exhibiting poor behaviours, they're speeding all the time, we don't want them on our fleet unless they start to exhibit better behaviours? So again, you know, it's with you. You have the power to do that. Yes, they're not your direct employee, but they are doing journeys on your behalf. So you absolutely have to be sure about it. So this for me is like a little roadmap. And this again is for kind of your own drivers. You can see there on the left-hand side, that's the health and safety legislation that will catch you under lots of areas where there may not be specific legislation. So more than welcome to take photographs, but if anybody wants a copy of the slides, I'm really happy to just send them out to you. So if you want a copy, that's absolutely fine. So obviously things like, you know, checking legal compliance, I would hope that's an absolute given, that should be BAU, everybody should be doing that. But we need to start to see that as the starting point of the journey of looking after your drivers. So all those other steps that you can see on there, this is kind of where you need to be going. You need to be looking at all the bits of legislation, thinking about the duty of care, thinking about what's that driver's life like from when he gets up in the morning to when he goes to bed at night, and what are we doing to ensure that he's safe. And I think probably one of the last things on there that I've put is about don't let the minimum become the maximum. And that's what a lot of us do. So the minimum is legal compliance. Don't let that be the most you do and think we've done everything we need to do because we are compliant. Somebody comes in, if DVLA come in, traffic commissioner comes in, we are doing everything that we need to do. You're not. You're doing the very, very basic minimum that you need to do. So, like I said, there's lots and lots of areas that we can cover on this. Lots and lots of different parts of a driver's life, a driver's actions, loading and securing, you know, all these sort of things that we should be very, very careful that we understand that everything's risk assessed. And let's be honest, if you've got a driving fleet, driving is the highest risk activity that they will do as part of their working life. The only two things that are higher risk that have a higher occupational mortality rate are deep sea fishing and coal mining. You are more likely to be killed driving as part of your job than anything in construction, civil engineering, so working at height, anything like that, even the nuclear industry. You are more likely to be killed while you are on the road driving for work than anything else that you're going to do. So in terms of putting some time and thought and energy into it, this is absolutely somewhere we need to be focusing on. So thank you. That's my presentation done. But please, anybody wants to ask questions, please do. And obviously, we'll be able to send this out to people.
Yes. Yes, no, thank you very much, Alison. We do have a roving mic if you do have any questions. Thank you.
Alison, first of all, great presentation, thank you. I met you yesterday, but yes. For the benefit of the room, my name's Paul Speed, I'm a fleet risk consultant for Aviva. Would you say that perhaps one of the things that companies using agency drivers a lot should do is to think of them as employees, involve them in things like driver WhatsApp groups, use the same induction process, things like toolbox talks, get them to sign for it, try and use the same drivers, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And is there anything more that you'd suggest that companies do?
Well, I think for a start, and this is not obviously going to work for everybody, I would say that the least agency drivers you can use, the better, because you've got far more control over your own drivers. I understand that that's not necessarily, you know, everybody can do that. But you're absolutely right. As soon as that person comes through your door, they're an employee. And it doesn't matter whether they're employed through the agency or not. And I think induction is actually one of the most important things, because if I come to work for you as a driver, if you don't tell me what your standards are, what do you expect of me when I'm doing that job? If you don't tell me, I don't think you care. And if you don't care, why should I care? So I think that, you know, that initial induction and a driver induction. So, you know, even with your own drivers, we see so many inductions that are all about HR issues, pay, holidays, all these sort of things. Really, really important. Pensions. And if you're lucky, you might get a little bit on the end about driving. You should have a driver induction standalone, because it is such an important thing. And like I say, if you're not going, these are our standards as a company. We take this so seriously that you're not getting in that vehicle until you've done this. That sends a message. And when that person's out on the road, that message stays with them. And that's why, again, you're quite right. Any toolbox talks, all those sort of things. And also, when we're talking about like the driver monitoring, let that driver know, if you've got telematics, by the way, you've got going to have telematics in your vehicle, and we are going to be looking how you're driving. And you've seen our induction. We don't expect you to speed. We don't want you to speed. We don't want you to be doing these things. Don't tell them. They don't know and they don't care. So you're absolutely 100%. They've got to feel just like part of your driving fleet all the time and right from day one. That's the absolute crucial thing. Don't let them behind the wheel until they understand what's expected of them.
Do you think... Oh, sorry, Simon. I was going to say, do you think also from the agency driver's point of view, when they know that you do care about them, they'll want to, you know, put themselves forward for that company, you know, that you're going to attract the best agency drivers there are, the most professional?
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the things that we struggle with today in our industry is recruitment. And we know that that's been a problem for a number of years. And a lot of that is because, I think if we're honest, we haven't really invested in our drivers, whether there are drivers or agency drivers. And I think we're starting to redress that balance a little bit now and starting to invest more. And drivers are wanting to stay with companies, so retention's increasing. But of course, if you come in as an agency driver and you come into a company who doesn't really care and you just go home at the end of the day, and then the company next door are going to offer you 5p an hour more, you'll move. But actually, if you go into a company and they go, you are one of us now, you're part of our driving fleet, we want you to be safe, we're interested in your well-being, we've got these health things you can have a look at, they've got all these toolbox talks that we'd like you to look at and blah, 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 that driver is much more likely to think, actually, I kind of quite like to work for these guys. Yeah. So whether that's as an agency or whether he thinks, I'm going to ask, you know, are there any vacancies coming up? Is there any opportunity for me to become part of it? Because people do like to feel they're part of something good. And I think it does make a difference. And from the we've done surveys with a number of our clients' drivers. And when we talk about sort of rewarding drivers for being good drivers, just a pat on the back, or some of the drivers getting like driver of the month and things, the difference that makes to people. And I think that is a real indicator that people like to think they're doing what they're doing well, and driving's no different than anything else that people do.
Sure.
So you're absolutely right. Yeah, give them that impression and they're much more likely to want to stay with the company.
Thank you.
Hi, Alison. Simon from Driving for Better Business, as you well know. I've got a point and a question. When you were talking about towing and putting young drivers in vans, you said training wasn't a legal requirement, but there's actually provision in the Health and Safety at Work Act where any task that it would be reasonably expected that training be needed to provide it to do it safely. So. Yeah. I would include both of those.
So that's what I'm saying about there's not a specific piece of legislation that says you must train a driver too. But that's why that kind of final, all that legislation there is duty of care, risk assessment, training to do the job properly. Driving has got to be looked at as a work activity. And that's where I think we fall down, or we have done in the past. You know, I'm a mains fitter, or I'm a highways agency guy, I do this, I do that. But you're also a driver, and actually, you're digging a hole in the road. You work for a gas company, you've got all your breathing apparatus deployed at site, you do it perfectly. You get in the vehicle, it's like the wacky races on the way back to the depot. It's a work activity. You know, it's something you're paid to do on behalf of your company. And you're absolutely right. What I was trying to get across is not like a bit of legislation directly focused to say, if you've a young driver, you need to. But of course, that's what that health and safety legislation's there for.
It shouldn't need spelling out, though, should it? No.
It shouldn't, but it does.
Yeah.
It does.
My question was around electric vehicle risk management, because we've had lots of talks here today based around procurement and maintenance of EVs, but I've not seen anybody talk about the risk management processes and how that might be different for putting drivers in cars, because surely at the very minimum you'd need to adapt a vehicle walk round check.
Well, there's a whole raft of things, and I think the start of it is that the walk round check. Definitely drivers need to get familiarisation with how it handles and the acceleration and all this. But of course there are further ramifications. So there is, okay, so what happens if you have an incident in an electric vehicle? Because you can't just be towed across the carriageway to the hard shoulder. There are lots of different things involved in an electric vehicle. And do our drivers know? And actually, as companies, are we aware? You know, do we all know how much longer it takes to remove an electric vehicle that may be break down or be involved in a collision? Because there are all sorts of safety issues around it. And absolutely, we all want to move towards it because it is the way to go. We've got a little bit longer now than we had. But still, I think most people are carrying on with that kind of decarbonisation programme. But yeah, it has to become part and parcel of driver training, and it absolutely has to be holistic and in every single thing about it. So not just about walk round check, not just about breakdowns, about absolutely everything that's different about that vehicle. So yeah, absolutely. And I think that we've enough now on fleets for this should be business as usual now, really, because a lot of fleets are nearly 50-50 now, you know, with electric vehicles. And I think one of the areas that gets missed is electric company cars, because who trains company car drivers? There are some companies that do, a hell of a lot don't. So even if you've got van driver training, what do you actually do with it? You know, who asks a company car driver to do a walk round check? I passed my test quite a long time ago now, so over 30 years, but my dad wouldn't let me out in my car until I showed I could change a wheel. And he also said, never walk round the front to the driver's side, always walk the long way around the car and check your tyres as you walk round. And I've never forgotten that. It's a very simple thing, but are we telling car drivers that we need to do that? Let alone car drivers who are now in an electric vehicle, which is a whole other problem. So yeah, I think, you know, we need to really invest in that, and we need to think about, as an industry, I think we need to think about how we tackle that and how we incorporate it into kind of the general training and information that we give people.
So do you think it's your dad's advice that got you into the industry? Is that a seed that was planted in your head?
For that to be the case, I would have had to be a safe driver at 17.
Okay, fair enough.
Now, I definitely will hold my hand up. Having motorbikes and lots of nice cars when I was younger, I don't think that I had that focus straight away. But it's certainly something that has stayed with me. You know, all that time ago, stayed with me over 30 years, and I always walk around my car that way and look at my tyres. I always do, and check the lights. Just something that's instilled in me. My daughter does it now because I told her that as soon as she passed the test. So I think it kind of... he drove for a living, so he worked for an electricity company all his life and drove every single day of his life. Never got a point on his licence, was never involved in a collision his whole driving career, which is very lucky because obviously it's not always your fault. But so there's obviously maybe something in the genes. Oh, there you go, tell her that. Yes.
Obviously, you're here sort of talking to the fleets. Do you also work with the agencies themselves?
So we've tried to. A lot of agencies don't really want to engage. Okay. And I think that is maybe because it then gives them something extra that they need to do with drivers. Right. So one thing I'd ask companies as well is, if you take agency drivers on, do you do a licence check or do you assume that the agency's done it? Because it would be easy to assume that the agency has done a check. Well, they might have done a check on that driver. Might have been 3 years ago when he first signed up. Have they done one since? Does he actually still have a valid licence? And one thing I know really, really clearly from my working as a magistrate, lots of people get their licences revoked and they don't even know. And when we start doing licence checks for companies, you'll always get a handful of people who have no idea that they've not got a licence, a valid licence anymore. And that's because they've been through a speed camera, the notification's been sent to them, they've moved house and not changed their address with DVLA, so they don't respond, so eventually the licence is revoked. So unless they're actually taking steps to make sure that we regularly are going to check licences, and I think, for me, it's a no-brainer, if you take agency staff on and they're going to be working with you, do a licence check. It's peanuts to do a licence check nowadays. Costs hardly anything. I don't think, in terms of reasonably practicable, should something happen, I think you'd find it really hard to argue against doing your own licence check, given that they're so affordable to do nowadays.
But expanding on that, do you think that it's a fleet should not trust an agency's vetting process at all?
I wouldn't say that.
Okay.
I don't want to be sued. But what I would say is you need to be confident yourself that everything's in place. So how much more effort really does it take for you to ensure that those drivers are safe, understand roads? You know, we've had drivers who have had collisions. We've been doing collision investigation with them and they've not been in the country very long and actually don't understand the road signage. So there's lots of different things you need to be really, really careful of. And I'm sure there are some agencies that are absolutely fantastic out there. I'm sure there are. But even if I knew an agency was fantastic, if I took a driver on, I'd still do those checks. Because you can outsource people to do things. You cannot outsource responsibility. You are still responsible. So I would say just make sure you do it yourselves.
I think it'd be nice as well, I guess, if there was some sort of platform where fleets could almost share best practice.
Yeah.
You know, I would highly recommend that you use this agency. We have, you know, for years, and which I guess is where you come in because you'll hear the good and the bad. So it's not all bad, I assume.
No,
you know,
it's not. There's some great agencies out there. I think the reticence with that has been the reticence with lots of things in the past. It's that there has been a recruitment issue. And actually, as a company who might be struggling, do you want to be telling other people, we've got this brilliant agency that we use... You use them, and then, how do we get the drivers now? And unfortunately, there's a lot of that happens, and you can understand it as a fleet, you know, ex-fleet manager. I absolutely understand that. You try and protect it, but actually, we should, and I think we are getting more open. And I would say, I think, you know, I've obviously been involved with Drive for Better Business for a long time. this is the sort of thing now that's changing the industry, because this is share best practice, share training, share knowledge, have case studies. Let's look at that. And then that's the way I think we'll get that information through. So maybe, Simon, that's something we need to look at, maybe to have some sort of portal where people have got good news case studies on things like agency drivers. Because I don't think we've got any case studies on from an age, have we? Yeah. Yeah.
You might need to say this again, Simon.
Yeah, just
okay.
For everybody's benefit.
Thank you.
The level of service you get from different driver agencies is very patchy, and there are some who specialise in drivers, and a lot of them will go above and beyond,
yeah.
or at least do what Alison's suggesting. But then there's others where you can get hire drivers from a more general employment agency, and they often, in my experience, don't maybe understand it's got the same importance as we would understand. So you need to do as much research into your agency,
yes,
as you can. And going back to the driving licence thing, it can't be that difficult if the agency has done a driver check for them to confirm that in writing to you,
yeah.
At the very least, can
yeah,
it?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But I mean, going back to your point before, I think if you treat that driver as a first-day employee of yours, then all that kind of goes away, because you're doing all that. You're going to be doing that. Yes, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, reputationally, that person then becomes your kind of representative on the road. And absolutely, yeah, it is. It is. And also, you know, somebody can have a full driving licence in January and they can easily get to June and have racked up totting points and lost a licence. Because we find it particularly where there's been a road speed change or maybe some roadworks and a temporary road speed change, and somebody's just got that kind of, oh my God, how have I got here? I don't remember driving the last 3 miles. Of course, it's all that muscle memory, and you do 60 down that road and suddenly there's a change or a temporary change. You can go through that and you can end up getting points over a couple of months. So really important. I mean, we recommend, and we for all our clients do quarterly checks. So every fleet that we manage the risk of, we do a quarterly check, because really, and we do monthly checks if somebody's on very high points, but really you need to be doing that regularly. It's got to be something that you look at, because it's so easy to amass points very, very quickly in some situations.
Any other questions, thoughts for Alison?
Thank you very much.
Thank
for
you very
everybody.
Much.
Safe journey home.
Yeah, I'm terrified.
And I expect you all to drive home safely. Please don't speed. I've no induction to give you, but
thank you very much. Thanks, Alison. Thank you.